Taken was amazing. Jennifer, has anyone seen the show Taken?
Yes.
Yeah, that's why it's canceled. Joke. That was a pure Nielsen data joke. Not about the show. The show was excellent. The acting was excellent. The production values. It was Friday night on NBC and no one watched it, as evidenced by that little thing that came out of the audience. I'm very proud of the work I did on the show. Oh my gosh, Clive Standen is going to beat me senseless. Because he's a Viking, you know. But to your question, incredible experience, treated generously. It pushed my envelope a little more, got to do action, got to do comedy, play a bad guy, and play another douche canoe, which apparently is my casting now. Single cookie making dads and douche canoes. So there you go. Thank you.
She has.
Doing it. We're sitting, Kim.
Oh my goodness.
Not yet. Not.
Okay, sorry.
But not, it's just because I'm old and I move slow.
Give her a sock.
The other day I reached down for something. I literally read. They moved the ground! It was right, I can't.
Somebody you back?
No, someone got it for me.
The ground?
I'm not kidding. I was reaching for a sponge and someone actually came and put it in my hand and I stood up.
I wonder if I do that. I wonder if I just like bend over for long and... Never mind.
I heard that. I'm like, everyone will help.
That's like where?
Yeah, exactly. If I bend over for long enough, what will I get?
Yeah.
Don't answer that. Pregnant! No, I'm just kidding. Oh, this is like a Saturday panel already. Okay. Good luck to y'all. Good luck. Are there any youngsters out there? Shut your ears. Right? Shall we? We have some sweet lineups. We didn't even start talking about our periods.
Ooh. Oh, yeah.
I can, though. I can.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. How do you guys memorize your scripts?
I don't. I don't. I have an earpiece. No, I'm just kidding. It is a muscle. And so over the years, I was not good at it when I was younger, and over the years, I've become better at it. But for me, I need to picture the words in my mind. And so I need to practice it a lot. So it doesn't look like while I'm acting, I'm going, "You should come with me!" Like that. Same for you guys, right?
You should come with me! Now, I have to, it depends. If I'm doing a play, I generally can't memorize until I'm up and wandering around, so I know where I'm supposed to stand. There's a lot more time with a play. With television, I have to figure out what the thoughts are, and then the words generally follow. If I'm having problems getting words, it means that I have not made up my mind what the hell she's thinking. To the point where there was a point when I was working, Jensen was directing me, and he came over and there was words I was getting wrong, and so I was just trying to get it. He came over and he goes, "What are you doing in this section right here?" I said, "I'm saying it as fast as possible so that I, because I don't know what I'm doing." He goes, "That's exactly what it looks like." No, he was right. And then he told me what my character was thinking, and I remembered the words. So, Jensen's magic. Is the story I can take away from this.
No, I don't cross between the two of them, actually. Sometimes I'm just like, I just need to see the words, and they kind of flash before me, and then they need to dissolve, and then I know what I'm saying, and then it's just actually remembering thoughts and intention, and then it's all fun. But it's not fun until all of that work is done. That's the truth.
Thank you.
It's Dave. Is it Davey? Is that right?
Yes! Yes!
Go ahead, Davey.
Can you come to my birthday party?
When is it?
When's your birthday?
November the 29th.
Yeah. November the 29th. What are we going to do at your birthday party?
Told her it was my birthday on Sunday, and then I'm turning 19. It's a big birthday for me. Can you believe I'm already 19? Oh, it feels so good to be older.
She's a big girl, isn't she? Wait, okay. So, I'm very serious about this invitation, though. November 29th.
Yeah.
What day is that? Hold on, I have my calendar.
And where do you live? Because I'll have to, like, talk to my travel agent.
Lafayette, Indiana.
Oh, yeah?
Indiana?
Lafayette.
All right.
Okay, that's a Monday. Spell your name for me.
D.
D-A.
E.
A.
D as in David.
Okay.
A as in Alpha.
D-A.
V as in Victor.
V.
A.
A.
N.
N.
I.
E. E-E. Okay, so, Davini, I will probably not be in Indiana on November 19th. 19th is the 29th.
29th.
Okay, there we go. Gotta make sure we get it right.
Are you or your mom on Twitter?
Yes.
That's on a Thursday. Yep. So, on the 29th, Davini is going to get a bunch of tweets for her birthday.
Yeah.
So, we might not be there, but it's in my calendar. I'm gonna give myself a warning and I'm gonna make sure I get you a bunch of messages and maybe my daughter will draw you a card. Would that be all right? Okay.
nice
Thank
to meet you.
Thank you for inviting us. That's very sweet of you. None of you other fuckers are getting that treatment. I want to be super clear.
I was just going to apologize to her for my language, and I was like, no, she knows us. She gets us.
Yes.
Right? Hey, turn the lights down. Turn the lights down! Thank
they
you.
Burn!
Thank you. I am so much prettier in the dark. Okay. That's why I didn't know it. All right.
Okay. I have a warning the day before. I'll text you.
Okay, thank you.
Everybody's going to find out. We're all going to remember this.
All of you. We're all in it together, y'all. All of you. Muffin, you got that. You fucked this up.
Got this, Muffin.
Oh, jeez. The loneliest muffin in the world.
It's a very sad muffin. Sorry, my clothes are falling off.
That's what she said. Never be sorry.
Okay. Hello.
Hello. My question is for Kim.
Okay.
If Cole and Dylan were on Supernatural, what would you want their characters to be?
Look at the face.
Huh. I think it would be funny just as a cameo, where Jody's over there going, my door is always open.
Nope. Oh, that is good, Kimberly.
That was from my former life. Never mind. And just goes on about her business.
My door is always open. Not for you, though. Back
no.
Back. I love that. Thank you.
Hi. I just saw Kim and Brianna at their photo op. Hi.
Hi.
And this is a question for all three of you guys. What's it like being women in Hollywood, first of all? And what's it like also being pretty much the only ladies really alive on Supernatural?
Is that true?
Yeah.
What about Sam's character?
Like that, Mary's around.
But they're in the alternate universe still?
No.
Charlie and Rowena are on a road trip. Rowena and Charlie are on a road trip.
Yes.
Mary's here.
They're on a road trip, yeah, Charlie and Rowena.
The girls
are all still...
All the girls.
I get your point, though. I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yes, and it feels good. Knock on wood. Because you know what I'm saying?
That's what she said.
You're a dirty little fucker. And I like it. You asked for it.
That's what she said.
Oh my God.
Feels good to be back.
Okay, let's take some time to answer this question. go ahead, Lisa.
Well, I mean, technically we're dying, so.
Oh yeah.
To me, there's no
we're
such
the
thing as death.
We're all dying. God damn it.
I'm like, so I died already, so I know what that feels like intimately. And, but now I kind of run shit, so I'm not mad at that. Death can't do nothing to me.
You know what, that's kind of what it feels like for me being a woman in Hollywood. Okay. Really, like, I've died a number of times. My career has died some explosive, disastrous, brilliant deaths. And according to Hollywood, I am dead right now. But according to my heart, I run shit and I'm happy.
I'm with Kim. I don't live in Hollywood. I live in Canada. So that's where all you do is you go to work and then you come home and tend to your garden. It's a little different, but yeah. It's all kind of the same bullshit that you imagine. A lot of younger, thinner, prettier, and all you do is you keep showing up. And then they go, oh, you're still here. Okay, fine. And then eventually, you get exactly what you want. So, keep showing up. Thank you.
Hi, ladies. First, I'd like to say happy birthday, Brianna.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you.
This has nothing to do with Supernatural.
But cool.
I'm a huge klutz, so I'm kind of wondering, what is the dumbest way you guys have ever hurt yourself?
Well, no, I got one right on, because I do this a lot.
Oh, give it.
There's a scar on my hand. But I think you're like this too, from what I hear. It's like, so I dropped, I was doing dishes, and I dropped a glass, and I was like, I picked it up, I was like, oh, it didn't break. It broke. And I just started bleeding profusely, and I was like, Robin, who was my roommate at the time, I think you should finish up with the dishes. I really do. And she comes in and she's like, whoa, are you okay? And I was like, actually, it doesn't hurt at all. I was so amazed by the experience because I was like, this is the greatest injury I think I've ever had. You know? So that's my favorite because I felt like Wonder Woman. I learned how to do push-ups on the tips of my fingers because I couldn't put my hand on the ground, and it was right at that turn when I was like at like the top of my, oh my God, I'm doing it,
yes,
losing all the weight and getting in shape, and I was like, I'm not stopping now, push us like that. So it's an iconic injury, but they happen all the time.
So dumbest way we've hurt ourselves, I don't know.
Standing next to a door talking to Ozzer Chow like this.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah.
And then he closed the door. Oh. You don't know about this?
Oh, yeah.
I do.
Yeah, yeah. He's inside the van. I'm outside the van.
Standing here, da-da-da-da-da-da.
Oh!
I'm in Nicaragua and this is going to be a problem. That was the dumbest thing, is not moving my hand fast enough.
Mine is always like, last Christmas, I threw my back out so bad I could barely get out of bed, and it was literally from doing this.
Don't do it.
I'm like, I do tons of shit where I can like really hurt myself, but no, this one did it. So beware of anybody looking to half bend over. It's dangerous. Thank you.
Thank you.
I love your little loved one. So cute. Hi.
Hi. Okay.
Is that Jade?
Stop.
Yes, clearly it is. I can't see, but now I know.
Of course. So I was wondering, when you guys kind of start feeling like the lonely muffin and you're a little sad and upset and you really don't feel like you have anybody, like, what do you guys do to keep yourselves from, you know, thinking that and feeling that and just that's all you feel?
What do I do or what works to get me out of it? Because those are two clearly different answers. Two is I throw myself a pity party. Oh, yes. I roll around in that shit. I validate all of the fears in my head. I eat ice cream over the sink at 2 a.m. I think about how good drugs and alcohol used to make me feel. I get in there. Not as much as I used to. What works? What I finally do is I remember when I feel like I have nothing, I give something away, and then I'm amazed at how much I have. So my suggestion, it's not advice, but my suggestion, my experience is that when I am in pain because no one loves me, I find someone that needs my love and I give it freely. And it works. I second that answer.
And that's why they're my soul sisters. I third that answer.
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, thank you guys, because that's how I've been feeling a little bit lately, and I really appreciate you that.
Anytime, girl.
Kim, I love you.
I love you.
I love you too.
Sorry, that was first name.
Come on, I just totally squandered off on that answer. You don't love me?
I love you too.
Just kidding. Don't ignore me. I need a lot of attention. Hello.
Hi, I'm Kim and Brianna. I met you guys yesterday at the PJ party, which was great.
But
the question is for Lisa. you knew. So I heard that there was a rumor going around that you were a fan of Supernatural before you got on the show. So is that true? Is my question. And then in general, what is your favorite episode? What is your favorite episode? Like, if you were on it or if you weren't, didn't work on it.
I am a fan of the show. It's true.
Do you want to know a funny thing? I'm going to interrupt you rudely right now. Is that they did the teaser that Phil built that you're singing on. I recognized her voice because Lisa and I have known each other for a long time. And then I saw you at the very end. You said something. Your character. And I think I messaged you and I was like, are you fucking on Supernatural now? She's like, yes! And I'm such a big fan of it! You totally were fangirling with me over a message. I was like, this is so cool. But I didn't even know.
I do. I love the show. I think it's a lot of fun. It's also been the show that somehow has been there for me at the time when I'm like, you're going through what I'm going through.
Aww.
Right. You get me. It was one of those kind of moments, and I think one of my favorite episodes is when they went through the parallel worlds, and all of a sudden it's like, you guys are actors, and Misha comes out and is like, are you guys running lines again?
French mistake. Yes. Yeah, that's everybody. I mean, that's my favorite.
Is that everybody?
I mean, it's my favorite, I think it's a lot of people's favorite, but it's my favorite because I know the crew. And I also live in Vancouver, so I know a lot of the actors that are playing the crew members that are my friends. So it's really kind of funny to see my friends playing my friends on TV. It's very heady shit, guys. But yeah, I love that episode.
I love it, but that's my favorite episode. And yeah, I do. I've seen the show, the series, a couple of times. I had a lot of time in my life at one point, and I used it all on Supernatural. Not a bad way to spend time. But what I love about having watched the show and know it as well as I do is it really did inform how I brought Billy to life. So that was helpful.
I love Billy.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ava.
Hi, Ava.
I was wondering, how has the Supernatural family impacted your lives?
I'm singing now. That's how it's impacted my life. I'll be straight. That is something that actually only happens here.
So. I think that was a big thing for a lot of people. I know we talked about it this morning, and I know you're nodding your head. Same thing for you, same thing for Ruth. Elena sang a song once. Yeah, it's not funny. We're like, singing.
I know, on a show that nobody's singing on. It's not like we're on Glee, but but that is definitely the thing. And then the love and support that followed the opening of the mouth and sharing our voices has been like the biggest transformative thing. And I know with Brianna and with Kim, it's just been so inspiring to me because I myself had so many limiting beliefs of just like, and I'm over 30, so I'm done. So that dream can die. And then they kind of reminded me that no dreams ever die. And I really, really appreciate that because it feels so good to sing.
I think it's literally given me a voice. I think it's not just a metaphor that I'm singing now, but I through the Phantom, I have come to believe that I have a unique value, not an inherent right, but a value. The Phantom has really been great at forcing me to not be a hypocrite. Because when people are paying attention to what you say, when you say one thing and they're watching what you do and you do another, y'all have no qualms about going, no, that thing, no, because you said this and now you're doing this, and those don't go together. And at first that was terrifying to me, because I was being asked to be responsible. Fuck you! You don't understand me! I would have met with, and I didn't, okay, now you're right. And so it's forced me to either acknowledge when I'm inconsistent and stand by it. Yes, I said that, I did that, and I believe both things, and that's okay sometimes. I'm sorry if that makes you uncomfortable. Or more often, what I do is go, oh yeah, that was inconsistent with who I want to be. So why don't you step closer to who you want to be, Kim? So because of you guys, I am turning into a person that I want to be. So thank you.
It would be a shorter answer for me to tell you ways that the show has not changed my life. My life is intensely different since being on that show in kind of every single way. I also was pregnant the first time I was on the show and now have a child, and so all of that is very different, and so she's estranged. Her whole life has been a part of the show too, and I feel like everything I have is in large part because of you guys. This album is entirely because and for you guys. A lot of opportunities that have come into my life, a lot of people that I've met, friends. Who just walked on stage? Who was that? Is Rich here?
You.
What's happened?
Rich flew in early.
Yeah, exactly. I could not go over all of the ways in which you and the show have changed my life, but they are many and many and many and many. And I will thank you until the day I die. I don't remember what side that came from. Thanks, person that's not there.
Hi, I'm Jen, and if I could, I would ask you all questions, but this is a question I've had for years. I'm turning 17, and for about 13 of those years, I've watched Kim on TV, and it's just like she's grown with me. And I just wondered if you knew that you had an impact on a bunch of Supernatural fans because you were with them since early childhood.
I don't think she knows, guys. I don't think she gets it.
So many people, the young Supernatural fans, and the people that watched Zack and Cody growing up, the people that just watched you their entire lives. I've watched you for 13 years.
My reaction. I don't think about it. Because it's huge. It's big, because this is so big. This is so big. And there's nothing in this human that is big enough to deserve that. So I just say thank you. And I want to be bigger and better so that you can be bigger and better too. I love you. Thank you.
I'll tell you, she has that effect on grown women too.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Courtney.
Hello, Courtney.
Hi. So my question is for Kim. Since you were on Criminal Minds and your character...
Sorry, guys. Sorry.
Stop apologizing.
They made me do do it. No, no, this one needs to be apologized for.
Yeah, your character was kind of a bitch.
That's accurate.
Since your character basically disbanded the BAU, my question is, what supernatural characters would you take to form your own BAU to replace them?
My own what?
Your own BAU.
Oh, wow. You guys can answer that too. Hey, what,
no.
What supernatural characters?
Thing she just said.
What's BAU?
The Behavioral Analysis Unit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, I would join any team.
No, no, death would absolutely, yeah. I mean, like, death has to be there.
Yeah, I
because,
be there.
Yeah.
Happily.
Forcing. Who's the profiler? What character would be a profiler?
Sam.
But he's not a creature. Well, I mean, he's a lovely creature. But he's not a creature. Rowena. Yeah, Rowena. Oh my God, the BAU full of Rowena, death. Who are we gonna throw in there? I can't just put all the people I want to play with.
Now whoever you say is gonna sound
that's
like
what she
don't
said.
Play them.
Like, yeah. Yeah. Oh my God, I don't know. I have to get back to you on that one.
Charlie.
No, we need a psychic. The profiler, I think Patience would have to be in there. Like, Patience would have to be in there because we've got this, well, she's gonna start, like, fixing her powers. And then Garth, because I like him. He can track shit. Thank you. Because Mr. Fizzles comes with Garth, and who doesn't want Mr. Fizzles on the BAU? Can you imagine that interrogation? Mr. Fizzles thinks you're lying!
Now I actually want to see that.
That's a different show.
I'm interrogated by a sock puppet.
I don't hate it. I don't hate it.
First of all, you guys all look so beautiful. Did you guys fangirl over anyone on set, like when you first started, like full on, just
the person writing the checks?
What do we do to you guys?
Well, I'll be straight.
Yeah,
I fangirled out a little bit when I saw Kim. I was walking up. Remember, it was a premiere in LA. And I'm walking out with my fiance and I was like, be cool. Be cool. She's right there. Hey, so nice to meet you. Hand goes out and she's like, hi. And I was like, true to Kim Rhodes' form, open arms. And I was like, I think I love you. And then it's been nothing but like, the best ever since. I truly think I worship the Church of Kim.
We're both pretty consummate professionals. But there was an episode we were both in that was out at a location, big house, and so Sam Smith, this beautiful lady, and I are all sitting there, and we were never on set when we were supposed to be. Ever. Because we were sitting, and they like stuck us back in the back. And then remember that big Malamute walking around? There was a big dog and Skaggy. And we were just like,
I know. And so it was so great. But I love you because, and it was just one of those.
You're like, where victory is up. Like, okay. No, I love you.
We need Lisa on set. I get it's a break for you guys, but we need Lisa on set. Okay. I get it's a break for you, but we need Kim and set. That's kind of how it went.
Yeah.
I love that story.
But you know what was really special, you guys? The day I met that powdered donut. Tears were shed. Donuts were spit out. It was funny. Every once in a while, people ask me to tell that story in a panel, and the
The joke was, because I was pregnant, I was all, yeah, I'm going to eat a donut in a scene. It's going to be hilarious and delicious. Well, not recognizing I would have to eat about a dozen donuts. So eventually, about six donuts in, I started spitting them out. And Jensen as well would do the same thing, but Jensen would always pass me the bucket and let me spit first. Aww. So you guys think it's cute. Everybody else thought it was dirty. So saddle up. And then somebody wanted, I think actually somebody did make me a t-shirt that said, Jensen lets me spit first. There we go. Thank you for your question. Sorry, Davey. Hi.
Hi. So I love all of you guys so much, but Brianna, I just have to say you are everything I aspire to be in life, and you are my role model, and I love you so much.
Oh, wow. Thank you. My question is for Lisa. Very much. No, no, you have to ask me a question.
Yes, I am.
Okay.
I just wanted to know. So I was listening to your album this morning, and I only cried four times. And I just wanted
to... That is such a weird thing for me to take in. So let me just do that for a second. Because that's so fucked up. And thank you, and I will continue to be weird about that all day long.
I wanted to know what song on the album was most important to you when you were making it.
Important to me. I still think, and this is my answer for a lot of the questions, because it was the first song I recorded, and it's the only song I've performed live, which is Better Than That. Better Than That is a song that I heard in such a random way. I follow some, you know, as we all do, Instagrammers who you don't know, they're influencers or whatever, and this was an influencer in Brooklyn that I was following. And she went to Suzanne Santos' concert in Brooklyn and taped just a 15-second snippet of this, her singing the song. And I was like, oh my God, this song's beautiful. I found it on Spotify, listened to it constantly, and the song was so much of what I was thinking and kind of going through or had gone through in my own life. I thought, if I could write a song, I would want to write this exact song. And I sent it to Jason, and sent, we were just going over ideas for the album at that time, and I was like, do you think that I could maybe cover this song? He's like, where did you find this? I explained the story, and he's like, this is a very good friend of mine. And so he just texted her, and she was like, fuck yeah. And so it was so meant to be, and that song, every time I sing it, moves me. I feel it so strongly. And it literally is, if I could write a song, that is the exact song I would write. So I think that I love that one the most. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, meant to be. Hi.
Hi, Kim. Hi, Lisa. Hi, Brianna.
Hello.
My question is, which female actors do you admire, like past or present?
Right now, Amanda Seales is really kind of, I don't know if you guys know who she is. She's on the TV show Insecure on HBO.
Ooh.
And she's just got a really great voice in this.
She's nominated for
Emmy. No, that was Issa Rae.
Oh, okay.
Different black girl, just kidding.
I haven't seen the show, I've only heard about it.
No, but she is, she's one of the characters on the show, and I started following her because I thought that she was just awesome on the show, and she's actually a stand-up comedian. She does all of these tours around the states called Smart, Funny, and Black, and it's basically to just educate the population in a different way from the way that most people have been educated about black people in America, and she's really on the pulse and funny about it, and she talks a lot about needing comedy in the world so that we can sustain ourselves through this change as we heal and as we grow. So she's my favorite right now because she's really smart, she's a wordsmith, and she's funny about it, which makes it easy to take the medicine in. And I really like her work, so, and I'd love to work with her.
Funny. I, for all of those reasons, am really appreciating, especially after working with her, Aisha Tyler. Like, oh, fuck, you're the whole package. And I so admire someone with a passionate point of view who gives you the medicine sweetly, with humor, with not like, you will take this, but instead is like, you want some of this, don't you? I also have really thanks to my daughter. I'm really appreciating Pink.
Me too.
I wish I could sing because I would love to do fucking perfect for Saturday Night Special. Her point of view and her commitment to it and yet her vulnerability and her willingness to let you see how scared she is to have that point of view has inspired me. So I'm gonna say, I know you said actors, but she's, I don't know, she's acted in shit. Pink. my inspiration in actors changes constantly, but what I, this is kind of a general answer, what I am very inspired by are relatable characters, but kind of not extraordinary characters. Characters like women from Glow. I really love that show right now. Orange is the New Black. Stories that are being told about people who lead regular lives. I grew up in a very regular household, and my mom would be the first one to say, I didn't achieve anything extraordinary in my life. Which is from the eye of the beholder, but I find something so inspiring in finding and watching the stories of women going through everyday hardships. It makes me feel like I can go through that. I don't need to go through anything extraordinary, but I can still achieve something incredible. Thank you.
My name is Valentina, and
What?
Yeah.
Oh my god. Okay, go ahead.
My question is, what advice would you give to teens that have big dreams and aspirations?
Big dreams and aspirations for?
Anything?
Okay. Yeah. I wasn't sure if you wanted to tell me more, but if you don't, that's cool. I always like to give out the answer because in my experience, the answer is don't give up. Because I should have probably given up so many times and I didn't. And then here I am, as we're talking about, an age where in Hollywood we should have been dead. But I also love to do things that scare me and that I don't know how to do. I have a tendency to say yes, and I've learned over the last month that I maybe should stop doing that for just a couple weeks because baby's tired. But I feel like, yeah, the only way to learn how to do something and to get good at it is by just doing it, which can be really scary. But I say fucking go for it. Beep. I found the danger with big dreams is attaching my happiness to their outcome. Because we all just watched me have a big dream. And we watched it not happen. And it broke my fucking heart. But I wasn't wrong for having it. And so, if I can tell you anything, it's that have a big dream because it makes your heart sing. But let yourself be happy without it.
If I can be happy now, then I can dream anything and ultimately be okay. So keep it. Keep dreaming. But never tell yourself, I'll be happy when. Be fucking happy now. I'm like taking all that in. I'm like, no.
Yeah.
I agree with both of these ladies. I think it's a beautiful balance of not giving up and allowing yourself to feel happiness and joy right now. For me, my personal belief is much like what Kim was saying, instead of attaching your happiness to a dream, let your happiness be the biggest dream that you have. Let yourself feel all the things, or ask yourself, what do I think that this big dream is going to make me feel? And then you can feel that now and take your time to achieve it without any expectation. Because you're not needing, like Kim said, you're not needing it for something. It's something you aspire to do because it sets your soul on fire. And your true joy is coming from the inside. And it's just so easy to put everything that we want on the dream rather than something that we can give ourselves from the inside out. And I really do believe that a lot of what we want or aspire to or these big dreams are because we really think we'll feel better when we have it. And we can always feel better right now and let it unfold how it's gonna unfold, because the journey is really the best part. So only looking to have a goal is going to leave you unhappy along the way. And so I would say whatever makes you feel happy on a daily basis as you aspire for that big goal or dream, you win. You win, you know, because a lot of people only focus on the goal and then they get it and they're unhappy. And success without fulfillment is the ultimate failure. So that's Tony Robbins. but it really resonates with me because we're in this era of social media where we see things happening so fast, we think that everything has to happen right now. And my generation had to deal with the fact that it's gonna take time. You're gonna have to pay your dues. And now we see people getting things without having to pay their dues or it happening super fast. That still isn't the rule. It's an exception. And social media makes you think that, you know, big dreams happen and then in a year you get it. And then we have a whole generation of kids who are unhappy because in their first year of trying something, they haven't achieved it. And it's like, talk to Oprah, you know? It's like, patience will be the virtue that will sustain you through the trials and tribulations of achieving that goal. So just to remember, you know, success without fulfillment is the ultimate failure, and to enjoy the journey and you'll really have a fun life. Make it good.
Hi. So I
wanted
to talk to Kim about Criminal Minds. I have two things. One, I want to know why you thought Barnes was a power-hungry hardass. Did something happen in her life that made her that way? And I'm dying to know if Kristen Bagnus is anything like Garcia.
You're dying to know, wait, what's the last part?
If Kristen Bagnus is anything like Garcia.
Vegas is anything
her,
like
her,
Garcia.
The character that, she, yeah. that the actress yeah. played.
Yes. What happened to Barnes to make her that way? I don't know. It was explained a little bit, but I think she just decided that's what she had to do to get what she wanted, and that she was right. And she's anything like Garcia. She's really smart. She's very kind. She's very passionate. Like the good sides of her, I would say, yeah. I mean, I didn't get to know Garcia that well, but she was lovely. She was very, very lovely. Yeah, she's just as quirky.
Okay.
She's just as, like, but she's a little more focused. There you go.
Guys, how was it? The three of you together on stage for the first time, right? The three of you. How was it?
Dreams do come true.
Awesome.
Here, Muffin needs a picture with you.
Oh, yeah.
And by Muffin, I mean...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Cute. See, not lonely anymore.
Eventually, it's going to be the not-so-lonely Muffin.
That's what she said.
That's what she said.
On that note, we'll be here all weekend.
Ladies and gentlemen, Kim Rhodes, Brianna Bessel, and Lisa Bowles. It's time to see. It's time to let me.
In my life.